Good morning, church. We're back with you again this week. Here we are at Fairmount Friends in the Sanctuary, and just so eager to be back with you guys, but we'll settle for this. But one day soon, we will be back together. You're probably going to notice my fingernails during the course of this.
Mine too.
Yeah, during the course of this video. Quarantine means you got a lot of daughter time, and I've got two daughters. I think you have two daughters.
I do too.
As well. And so that means makeup.
Fingernails.
Makeovers.
Face paint.
They do my hair all the time. And fingernails, for sure. But we're just having a good time with that. If any of you out there, you're going through some hardships during this coronavirus, please be intentional to reach out.
Mm-hmm.
We would love to have you contact us here at the church with our phone number and our website right here at the bottom. And if you could, just reach out, because we want to try to meet as many needs as we possibly can. Today, we're coming at you from Hebrews chapter 12. But if you know how your numbers work, it's preceded by chapter 11. And chapter 11 talks about all of these major players that were unbelievable in the faith. They call it the hall of faith. And they say they overcome all of these obstacles throughout life. And so they set up what Moses did and Abraham did and on and on and on. All of these legends is how they set this up. Coming into chapter 12. So we're like, we get this huge picture of the legends of the faith from the scripture. And then it comes in verse 12 and it says, so therefore, right? So we saw how these men and women lived. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, these people that are peeking in on our lives, that are cheering us on, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of your faith, for who the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross and scorned its shame and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured this opposition from sinful men, that we would not grow weary or lose heart. I believe that there are some things that God would want to teach us and some things that we need on how we're going to run our race. Alyssa, we've ran a few races in our lives, some 5Ks, and then we kind of scaled up to some of those sprint triathlons, and then it even moved up to
Indy Mini.
Yes, we did an Indy Mini. We did a few of the Indy Minis, which is 13 miles. And the point one will get you.
It will get you.
No doubt. You think you just ran 13 and that point one will knock you down for sure. And then we did an Ironman in New Orleans. It was a half Ironman, 73 miles, point three as well. Don't forget that last quarter of a mile. And during these races, there was so much, as this says, run with perseverance. There's a race that's marked out for you. And so I just want to pull some nuggets out of what you need to run a race well. Number one, you need energy, don't you? You got to have fuel in the tank. You got to have energy to get after it. And a few things that I find for energy to have to help me run this race of faith and to overcome the obstacles that would press against me, like these men and women that overcame these hardships of life because of their faith, having high levels of energy comes from the supernatural wind at your back. I know what it's like running against the wind, and I know what it's like riding my bike in New Orleans with the winds coming off of the Gulf or coming off Lake Pontchartrain hitting you in the face, and you're trying to pedal up and down hills, and you're out in the bayou and across the swampland, and these winds can push against you. Having the wind of the Holy Spirit and just asking, God, would you just help me through life? Would you endorse this effort? Would you push me and strengthen me here. I also find that joy in the Lord is our strength. In Nehemiah, he says, "Would the joy of the Lord be your strength? The joy of Jesus fill you." And I know that whenever I'm sad, I'm frustrated, I'm angry, it just sinks my spirit to where I don't have the zip to get up and go. The best thing I could do during that day is just go to bed, just take a nap and get out of here. I need a fresh energy. I need to find joy in a higher place than I can in just the circumstantial things, because circumstances will lead your joy and happiness in the wrong way, because things don't go well often. And so how do we live lifestyles of faith where we overcome the hardships? And we need that fuel in our tank. Ever had a time where you literally didn't have fuel in your tank?
Couple times, actually.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about that.
Well, probably the most interesting one was when we, as a family, were headed out west to Colorado, and we're traveling across Kansas. And I don't know if you've ever traveled across Kansas, but number one, it's flat. Number two, it's boring. Number three, lots of cows. Number four, no gas station.
Ah, Kansas is long.
So before you get on I-70 going through rural Kansas, get your gas.
Come on.
Anyway, so we're getting lower on our gas tank, No gas station in sight. We thought, oh my gosh, we've got our kids in the car. What are we going to do? And all of a sudden, the radio turns off.
Oof.
There's nothing worse than traveling across Kansas without music, okay? So the radio turns off, and then next, the air conditioning turns off, and we're going, we're losing it. We're losing power.
Shutting down.
We're losing our energy. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. And then the power steering was next to go.
Yeah.
So we are starting to lose a lot of energy in this car. And then all of a sudden, the car started slowing up. And Brock's like, I've got it. I've got the gas all the way to the floor. I was like, oh, we are not going to make it. And then all of a sudden, I don't know who saw it first, but up on the horizon was a lone gas station.
Hark.
Do you see it?
Yes.
Our saving grace.
And there hasn't been one in miles.
Not one in miles. And we think that the Lord put it there. He had to have put it there because there wasn't even anybody working in the gas station. It was a pay at the pump type of deal. Anyway, so but we're slowing up. We're losing gas. And all of a sudden, there's one hill. The one hill in Kansas, thank the Lord, was the off-ramp. So we get on the off-ramp and we start heading down. But then there's this little incline up to the gas station. And we crept and we crept and we crept up that hill, and then it
stopped. Oh, shoot. That was discouraging.
So then Brock gets out and he's trying to push the car while steering the car. And it was just, you are so strong, honey, but it just wasn't happening.
Tell
that
the people.
Day.
Amen.
He is the man.
Come on.
But then the Lord had to have sent this trucker, and he stopped and he helped push us up this hill, and we could fuel up. We could get our fill so we could continue the rest of the journey safe and sound. It was awesome.
It was actually a great story. It was a great story. And it
we
was
were
wild.
Laughing.
We had a great time because the adventure is not always what is perfectly
like
scheduled and what happens perfectly every time. It's the wrinkle in the story. It's the curveball that always makes it a little bit more interesting and fun.
Mm-hmm.
Lance Armstrong was one of the best to do it whenever it came to these races on a bike. He did Ironmans. He did it all. But one of the things whenever he got caught up in the whole, doing the performance enhancing drugs and things. One of the things that he would do, these blood transfusions, except it was with his own blood. They would withdraw blood from him, fill it with fresh oxygen, and spin it all together, and then pump his own blood back into him. And so there wasn't really ever tested for drugs, but he just had fresh oxygen back into his body again. It was like the guy was just running on jet fuel. His blood never wore out. So he's just pumping fresh blood to his body all the time while everybody else is riding and their blood's getting thick and their blood's wearing out and it is tired and it is breaking down, his blood is fresh and he just keeps going. So while everybody is slow and he's only getting faster, there were some races where he got faster as the race went on. He was operating with this other synergy, this other worldly realm that people didn't have access to. He had jet fuel. And there's an energy that comes from heaven where you're able to tap into a higher realm, because this lower realm will suck the life out of you. So we've got to gain altitude and we've got to go up to these heavenly places and pull the joy from Jesus. Mm-hmm. He was the happiest person to ever step foot on planet Earth. He was anointed with the oil of gladness. He walked around in the strength of joy. Mm-hmm. And that is like fuel to your bones to run this race well. Another one is, it's helpful to be in shape when you do a race. We've done them out of shape and we've done them in shape. You actually did the Ironman pregnant.
I just had Nora.
Just had Nora and then says, let's go do the Ironman.
Don't recommend it.
Yeah, fascinating. Just trying to get your body to recover and just jumps back into the race. She's wild. The legendary cat from Fairmount, it was Garfield, and Garfield said, I am in shape. Round is a shape, right? And so you might think that you're in shape, but there is a way to get into a shape where you get physically fit. And as we're talking about this race to run for Jesus, spiritually fit and lean and sharp and focused. And where we just cut off the extra fat in our lives. The Bible says to throw off the stuff that's going to slow you down in the race.
Yeah.
I've got some stuff that kind of slows me down back here. I just can't get this stuff off the back. But it slows you down. What are the things that are slowing you down in life? Those sins that are tripping you up. They're obstacles that you can't run this race as quick with the speed to get up and get after it, to live missional, to where your mind is free and it's not always lethargic. And I don't want to go do that. And I don't want to walk across the street and love my neighbor. And I'm just wiped out. Or maybe my heart's just so offended. It's not in a healthy place.
Yeah.
To live offended is to live weak. Living offended is a weak place. We got to live offense-free. I'm not offended. I'm going to go love. People's behavior doesn't move me. It doesn't hold me down. I'm going to go love. I'm going to go serve. I'm going to have the joy of Jesus. I'm going to challenge and I'm going to encourage and sometimes correct and whatever. But I've got a race to run. There's a race marked out for me and I can't get tripped up by everybody else not running their race. I got to go, right? And so we got to get in shape. We got to get our hearts in shape, our minds tuned up so that we can get after it and run this race well. Number three, I think we need is a mindset. It says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author, the perfecter of our faith. We need to fix our focus and get that focus fixed on this God-man, Jesus Christ, who is fully alive and get after who he is. I got to have a mindset also of suffering. It says, know this, that Jesus suffered through it all, and let us consider him who suffered. Let us think about this person that we're following suffered. And so we got to do some hard things. Whenever we do the trainings and we do these races, I've had people just ask me, like, why would you want to voluntarily swim a mile and practice for 6 months swimming a mile and then bike for 50, 60, 70 miles? Why do you want to run for 15 miles? Like, you're volunteering to do that? Like, that's fun for you? And so the idea of embracing the grind is not even on people's mindsets. That didn't even register. To embrace the hardship. And I'll remind them, like, yeah, it's hard. But also getting fat and old is hard. We're both choosing something hard. And you're choosing an unhealthy hard. And I'm choosing a healthy hard. Life is going to get hard.
Yeah.
And so which way would you rather have it? It's the mindset, knowing that sometimes it's just going to be hard. So I got to get in shape. I got to bring some energy and I got to power through those things that are hard. That's how you get into the hall of faith. That's how you get to another level. These men and women of God that just had a little extra something to them. And so church, we just can't be attenders just people that just kind of waltz in. No, we've got to take on and embrace the full thing of Jesus, right? Which was, there was a grind, it was hard, it was surrounded by people, it's laying your life down, it's full of joy, it's awesome miracles, it's breakthrough, it's all of it, right? And having a mindset like that. As we're going through the coronavirus, by the way, do you know what corona means?
Me?
Yeah, do you know what
I do.
What?
Crown.
How do you know what corona means?
You taught me.
Okay.
My pastor.
Okay, then. We've been talking about this.
Been talking about the corona is a crown.
The corona is a crown, so just tell the people. What
Come
else?
On,
what
it.
Else does corona mean?
A garland.
A garland, yeah. So a crown or a garland that goes on your head. So crown, I think of, what do you think of with crown?
King.
I think of a king. I think of
queen.
Authority. Definitely a queen. Come on, church. A garland is like those wreaths that you would place upon your head, like in the Olympics. The victor that would win would get the crown of the garland victor. And so here we see in this corona thing that we are in a race. Who's going to be the victor? We are in a battle. Who is the number one authority? Right? There are authorities clashing on who is going to wear the crown. And whenever we prophesy over our country that we have a coronavirus, we're saying we have an authority of a virus in our land. And I'm saying that we have the ultimate corona. We have Christ corona. We have Jesus.
My corona.
My corona.
I might turn that into a worship song.
That sounds like a good idea to me.
Sorry,
it's my corona. He's the ultimate corona, except he's not a coronavirus. He's a corona king. He's the corona authority. He has the corona crown properly fitted upon his head. He's reigning and ruling. And I've got to have the mindset that the ultimate corona lives in me. Mm-hmm. And that I'm the corona walking here on the, I am the life of Christ marching out in this race. In this battle, that we will wear the garland of victory, that we overcome, that we win. We're going to bring our energy. We're going to bring our focus and have a mindset that comes with this thing. We will overcome it all. We got to get some jet fuel pumping in us. Get renewed. He renews us every day. I got to fix my mind, right? I got to have my renewed mind as I get after Jesus. And number four, I think is the last one, is we got to have people. Right? It says there's this cloud of witnesses that are cheering us on. And whenever we do these races, one of the coolest things are people on the outside that are around that are cheering you on. Come on, go get it. Even people that were doing the race alongside. I remember most people pass me as we're biking, as we're running, and
the 80-year-olds
passing me. He's like, come on,
you can see their ages on their calves. Yeah. And as they bike past you, like, he's 80.
We get marked up. So they have markers on your arms and tell what number you are. And then on your back calf, they write your age. So you know what age group you're in. 80-year-olds, 60-year-olds, 90-year-olds, 50-year-olds.
Like,
everybody's passing me. Yeah. Hey, little boy, you're doing fine. I'll see you at the finish line. And so anyway, they're passing by, but they're saying, come on, kick it. You got what it takes. Let's get after it. You got to have people in your life. And so isolation removes those people. So we've got to be extra intentional to make those phone calls, to reach out, to get the right people, the life givers, to be in our world. I know doing these races with you saves my time and saves my life many times. Alyssa's like, come on, you can do it. I'm like, okay, I'll get there. And she's encouraging me. And encouragement is like oxygen for the soul. Yeah. Encouragement is like that fresh jet fuel. It's like oxygen in your blood. Ooh, just keeps you fresh and focused and after it. I remember doing one of our races, and one of my best buddies on the planet, Lonnie Dyer, is there. And he's riding his bicycle all over, and he's showing up at certain marks, and he's yelling, come on, get it. This is what Lonnie does. Get it. Let's go. And he gets all fired up and energized. And man, when your energy can be contagious to other people, it just pops your spirit. Whenever I did the race in New Orleans, my boss at the time, or he was a guy that I had, how did that work? Yeah. Kevin McKnight was the general manager at a restaurant, New Orleans Hamburger and Seafood. And he shows up, he's tracking me on his phone, how we're doing in the race. And Alyssa and I were doing this race together, and we come up to the finish line. And right before the finish line, they're playing the song, "I'm coming home, coming home, tell the world I'm coming home." And we're all pumped, we're like, we're about to cry, it's emotional, and we're coming up to the finish line. And Kevin McKnight comes out of the crowd, and he's standing in the middle of the road. Awesome. And he's like, yell, come on, you can do it, you got it. And I come running up to him and I jump and he holds me, he catches me in his arms and I'm like, yes. And he's cheering me on and drops me and smacks my butt. And we come running up to the finish line and I grab Alyssa and I dip her at the finish line, kiss her, and we skip across the finish line together. It was awesome. It was powerful. But having those people that are cheering you on along the way and having people that will do the race with you is powerful. Mm-hmm. There's a race that's marked out for you. And there's some hardships along the way. Maybe there's some physical things, some spiritual things, relational things going on in your family, financial struggles, who knows what all of the struggles. But we can do this, we can overcome. And God is for us, He is not against us. And He wants to see us power through this race, to bring our best energy, to get in shape and focus, to have the mind of Christ, to have a mindset here, and to have the right people around us that we can get after everything that He's called us to do. Yes. We can do this.
We can do this.
Come on. There is a higher Corona in the land, and let's reign and rule with Corona Christ the King. And that's what we're prophesying over our country. We cannot wait to be with y'all soon, and we will be back together very, very soon. We love you guys.
Love you.
And we'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.
'Cause we get a bike ride in and a run. Doing the bike rides with the kids are so helpful because that's like the pace I like to go at. It's about 2 miles an hour.
Nora leads the pack.
When Nora leads, it's so helpful. I can keep up with that pace.
How many mamamamais are there?
Mamamamai Corona. Mamamamai Corona.
Are you sure you're right? No. How many mice?
My Corona. My Corona. My.
Woo! A poof on top.
Poof on top. A poof on.
A poof on.
I'll take a poof on top, please. A poof on. A gray poof on top.
Not a gray poof on. You don't want gray. Mm-mm. Highlighted.
Definitely colored and highlighted poof on top.
Get your mind right.
Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the authority, the perfecter of our faith. For the joy that was set before Him, He endured the cross.
You endured that.
And let us run with perseverance.
Sorry.
You okay?
Yeah.
Fire it up. Got a little charismatic right there for a moment. We were dancing in a Quaker church.
I can't move. My hair is right where I want it to be.
Me too. Don't move your hair.
Can't move your hair.
Just so hungry though.
Right.